If you want to implement a reactive application, you not only need to adapt your way of thinking and switch to reactive libraries for your business layer, you also need to access your database in a reactive way. One way to do that is to use Hibernate Reactive. It's based on Vert.X and implements the well-known concepts of JPA and Hibernate ORM based on the reactive programming paradigm. Hi, I'm Torben Janssen, and today I will show you everything you need to know to build your first project using Hibernate Reactive. But before we proceed, if you're new here and you want to learn how to create your entity mappings with ease, build incredible efficient persistence layers with Hibernate and Spring, and all types of other Java persistence-related stuff, subscribe and click the bell to get new videos every week. And also don't forget to like this video if you learned something new. That helps me reach a broader audience. Before you can use Hibernate Reactive in your application, you need to add the required dependencies and configure it. The only two dependencies you need are Hibernate Reactive and one of Vert.X Reactive Database clients. When you add these dependencies, make sure that Hibernate Reactive supports your chosen Vert.X version. Otherwise, you'll get some strange exceptions when executing your test cases. Let's take a look at that in the IDE. In the examples of this video, I will use a PostgreSQL database and therefore use Vert.X PostgreSQL client. You can use almost the same persistence.xml configuration for your Hibernate Reactive project as you use in your Hibernate ORM projects. The only difference is that you need to reference org.hibernate.reactive.provider.reactive-persistence-provider as your provider. After you added the required dependencies, you can start working on your entity mappings. As described earlier, Hibernate Reactive is based on Hibernate ORM, which implements the JPA specification. As of now, Hibernate Reactive supports most of Hibernate ORM's mapping annotations, and you can reference my previous articles and videos about Hibernate and JPA that you can find on my blog and on this channel if you have any questions. Commonly used annotations that are currently not supported are many-to-many and element collection. But that's not a huge issue. I recommend avoiding element collection in general, and instead of a many-to-many association, you can map the association table to its own entity class with two many-to-one associations. All entities need to fulfill the JPA requirements. Here you can see an example of an entity that maps information in the chess player database table. It maps the first and last name of the player, their date of birth, and two associations to the games they played as white and black. The mapping annotations on the ID attribute mark it as the primary key attribute and tell Hibernate to use a database sequence to generate unique primary key values. Based on your entity mappings, you can then implement your database access. Similar to the entity mapping annotations, Hibernate Reactive adapted the session factory, session, and query interfaces. You can decide if you want to use them based on the mutiny or completion stage API. In the following sections, I will provide you an example for both APIs. As explained earlier, the configuration is based on JPA, and you can use the standard JPA APIs to get your Entity Manager factory. In the next step, you need to decide which API you want to use and unwrap a mutiny.sessionFactory or a stage.sessionFactory. In the next step, you can then use the session factory to get a session and execute your operations. The reactive session interface offers the same methods that you know from Hibernate ORM. To persist a new chess player in your database, you need to instantiate a new chess player entity, call the withTransaction method on your session factory to get a session with an active transaction, and call the persist method. Hibernate Reactive will then flush your new entity and commit the transaction automatically. Using Hibernate Reactive, you can query your entities in the same way you do with Hibernate ORM. You can call the find method on your session to get an entity by its primary key, or write queries using JPQL, Criteria API, and native SQL statements. But there's one important difference. Hibernate Reactive doesn't transparently fetch lazy associations. You either need to fetch them as part of your query using a join fetch clause or an entity graph, or you need to initialize the association programmatically. Let's use the join fetch clause first. It's the recommended approach because it provides better performance than the programmatic initialization and is easier to define than an entity graph. If you already retrieved an entity from the database and want to fetch an association programmatically, you need to call the session.fetch method. The easiest way to update entity objects is to query them from the database and call one or more of their setter methods. When you do that, make sure to call the withTransaction method on your session factory to get a session instance with an associated transaction. Hibernate Reactive will then handle the required flush and commit operations for you. And you can remove entities in a similar way. You get a session instance with an associated transaction, query the entities from the database, and call the session.remove method for each of them. If you're already familiar with JPA and Hibernate ORM and want to implement a reactive application, then you should try Hibernate Reactive. It enables you to use the same mapping annotations and APIs that you already know from Hibernate ORM. There are also several differences, like the fetching of lazy associations and the missing support for a few mapping annotations. But these can be easily handled and they shouldn't prevent you from giving Hibernate Reactive a try. Okay, that's it for today. If you want to learn more about Hibernate, you should join my free member library. It gives you free access to a lot of member-only content like cheat sheets and ebooks about using JPA and Hibernate. I'll add the link to it to the video description below. And if you liked today's video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe below. Bye!